Good morning, students. We'll be continuing with the chapter, The Ailing Planet. And after that, we'll be discussing the question answers of this lesson. So what are the four main biological systems? Yes, do you remember? Can you tell me? What are they? We have the fisheries, the grasslands, the croplands, and the forests, right? So these are the four major biological systems. And these four systems are very important for the planet, and it is that the whole, you know, like the global economy, it rests on these systems. And everything is obtained from them except as for your petroleum-based derivatives and your minerals and your other resources. And these four systems are very important. And if there is an imbalance in any one of them, it is definitely going to create a dangerous situation for our planet and for our survival. Now, how have these systems been exploited? Can you tell me? Yes, what are the fisheries? How have they been exploited? Come on, let me hear some answers from you all. How are the fisheries being exploited? Overfishing, yes, and to such an extent that we do not give time to the fishes to replenish themselves, right? Then what about the forests? Deforestation, the cutting of the forest, it leads to, yes, loss of habitat of many species, right? And the tropical forests, they are the powerhouse of evolution. Maximum biodiversity there, but because of human activity and what is happening, there is a loss of habitat for the animals, which endangers them, which puts them in a dangerous situation. Some species have gone extinct also. Right? What about the croplands and the grasslands? So grasslands, overgrazing leads to erosion, leads to more problems. We talk about landslides, all this. We talk about barren landscapes, so the grass there, the cattle, and even, yes, for human activity also, areas which are required. Then we have the croplands. So what have we done to the soil? More than what is required, the fertilizers, the pesticides, they go into the soil and once again, they come back into our system, leading to a number of diseases, leading to a number of problems. So we have spoiled the systems here, so the biological systems. Then we talk about Article 48A of the Constitution. What does it talk about? It talks about the need to save wildlife and the forest, how the state has a responsibility. But once again, in India, every law is broken. Rules are not strictly enforced. And taking care of the environment, as I said, it may be the least concern, right? So we have people not taking care of the environment, the forest being cut, the wildlife in danger. We started with a discussion about human population, overpopulation, excessive population, because of advances in medical sciences, because of longer life expectancy. What has happened? The human lifespan has increased, right? And as a result, yes, we have a booming population. And how the numbers have multiplied, right? From 1800 to 1900, and now we talk about 2022, how every 4 days the world population increases, right? And of course, as the population increases, more resources are required, water is required, land is required, everything is there required, right? But the resources are limited, the land is limited, the water is limited, and we do not have enough resources to take care of everybody's needs, right? And of course, human activity is also spoiling, how we have discussed that. Now let's come to the reading of the chapter. So we're discussing human population, how this overpopulation creates a lot of problem. Okay, fertility falls as income rises, education spreads, and health improves. Thus, development is the best contraceptive. But development itself may not be possible if the present increase in numbers continue. How can development happen? Right, we're talking about development, but when the population is increasing, how can it be possible to make sure that change happens everywhere? Right, so fertility falls as income rise. So what is said that education is the best means of creating development. People become aware of health, of taking care of their health and the family's health, and they become aware about the disadvantages of large families, right? So it is there, it is said to be that development is the best contraceptive, right? It's a control method for controlling the population growth. But if the numbers keep on increasing, if the population keeps on increasing in this manner, it's going to be very difficult for the development to take place. The rich get richer and the poor beget children, which condemns them to remain poor. So the rich people, they're getting richer, the poor are getting poorer. And yes, because they don't have, it's a vicious circle they are bound in. More children does not mean more workers, merely more people without work. What do people think? They have more children, that means they can send them all to work. But what is there also which people don't think about is more mouths to feed, more resources required, and what if they don't get work? What will it mean? It will mean more people without work. It is not suggested that human beings like cattle and compulsory sterilized, but there is no alternative to voluntarily family planning without introducing an element of coercion. So we're not saying that just like animals, everybody should be sterilized. So we control the human population, but there has to be an alternative. What is that? Family planning. So people need to realize that they need to have small families if they want that everybody should benefit from development. Everybody should have access to the available resources. So the choice is really between control of population and perpetuation of poverty. So we have to decide here, yes, if we can control the population, we can also control the poverty. Otherwise, if we have here families, larger families, and more mouths to feed, more people without work, more unemployment, what is going to happen? That poverty is going to continue. What is perpetuation of poverty? The continuing of poverty, that state of poverty will remain, okay? So population is one very important factor. And yes, here, so government needs to take some action, needs to make some policies to control the population, right? And of course here, to make sure that all the benefits are availed, all the resources are available. This can happen if we control the population. Population of India is estimated to be 920 million today, much more now. More than the entire populations of Africa and South America put together. Just see now, right? No one familiar with the conditions in India would doubt that the hope of the people would die in their hungry huts unless population control is given topmost priority. So it's very important that we take care of the population, right? And only then we can hope for progress, only then we can hope for change. Right. So you see pictures here, even nowadays, of course, about marketplaces, about any festival and all, so much of rush and so much of crowd. And look at the population here. Population is there, adding to the problems. For the first time in human history, we see a transcending concern. The survival, not just of the people, but of the planet. But yes, our thought process needs to change. There's a change happening. People are concerned not only about themselves, but about the planet. If the planet is safe, if we are able to save the planet and we are taking care of the planet, only then human population will survive. We have begun to take a holistic view of the very basis of our existence. Holistic. We cannot survive alone. We cannot, right? And yes, the earth, it is not one individual's responsibility. It is everybody's responsibility. So we need to take care of it. The environmental problem does not necessarily signal our demise. It is a passport for the future. So there's hope also. There is positivity. There's optimism. Environmental problem does not necessarily signal our demise. So if there is a problem with the environment, if there's a problem with the earth, does not mean that the human population is going to come to an end. It means that we need to be concerned and we will make our future better. It is our entry for the future. It is our passport for the future. The emerging new world vision has ushered in the era of responsibility. So the changing vision has ushered, it has brought in the era of responsibility. What era are we living in now? One of responsibility. How responsible? That we will be taking care of the planet, right? So that our future is better. It is a holistic view, an ecological view, seeing the world as an integrated whole rather than a dissociated collection of parts. Earth is one unit. Something happens in one place, it affects the other parts of the world. Just a minute, we've had some issue here. Okay, can you hear me? Yes? Right, fine. Now, what is it that we are here? It's a holistic view, rather, it's an ecological view, and we have to realize that the earth, it has to exist in as one unit, it's not individual parts. So we have to change our opinion about the planet Earth. Industry has the most crucial role to play in this new era of responsibility. Industry is very important. We talk about how the industries are causing pollution, how the industrial waste going into the water, into the soil, creating so much of problem. What a transformation would be affected if more businessmen shared the view of the chairman of DuPont, Mr. Edger S. Willard, who 5 years ago declared him to be the company's chief environmental officer, CEO. So he didn't call himself the chief executive officer, but the chief environmental officer. He wanted to see that his industry, it should be environmental friendly. It should be safe, should be concerned about the environment. Our continued existence as a leading manufacturer, right, so you want to talk about tires, yes, that we excel in environmental performance. So if we are there, we're a leading manufacturer, if we are earning so many profits, it's time that we think about giving back to the planet also, right? So we need to take care of the environment. Of all the statements made by Margaret Thatcher during the years of her prime ministership, none has passed so decisively into the current coin of English usage as her felicitous words. No generation has a free hold on this earth. This planet does not belong to you, does not belong to me, did not belong to our ancestors. It belongs to the future generation. All we have is a life tenancy with a full repairing lease. We have tenants here. And the lease is going to be renewed, right? Again and again. So the next generation is going to get that lease. But no one owns this earth. We are tenants. And yes, and as tenants, we should behave responsibility with great responsibility We need to take care of the planet, make sure that our future generations also get to see this beautiful planet Earth in all its beauty, in all its beauty of nature, right? They should also get to see, right, the clear blue skies, the clean water, the forests, the greenery, everything around them. And let's not become so selfish that we spoil this planet for our future generations. Okay, so here once again, what are the words of Mrs. Margaret Thatcher? No generation has a freehold on this earth. All we have is a life tenancy with a full repairing lease. In the words of Mr. Lester Brown, we have not inherited this earth from our forefathers. We have borrowed it from our children. It does not belong to us. It has not been passed on to us, right? We have borrowed it from the future. We have, you know, like take care of it for our future generations. So that is why, like we're wondering, okay, so what do I care? I don't know how long I'm going to live on this planet. As long as my needs are met, why should I take care about others? Like one day you wake up, there is no water. What are you going to do? What are you going to do, right? Yes, you realized that you have, even if it is a few days or in the year when the air quality becomes so bad, we have difficulty in breathing, right? What if it is like this every day? What are we going to do? So we need to take control of the situation. We need to do our little bit. And if everybody does a little bit, little by little, it's going to make great efforts, right? So every big journey, you know, every great journey, it starts with a small step. So if we start doing our little part, we will ensure that our earth remains safe, our environment remains safe, because we need to take care of our needs also. Even if it is for selfish reasons that we are taking care of the planet, we have to. Because we're not the only one living on this planet. There are so many other species who are there living on this planet along with us. Okay, right? So we have not inherited this from Earth from our forefathers. We have borrowed it from our children. We've borrowed this planet from you. So we need to take care of it. So we should hand it over to you in a good condition, a condition that you can use. Now look at the lines in the text that support the title, The Ailing Planet. In the first paragraph itself, it shows that it's the sign of a patient. What does it notice the world's most dangerous animal at a cage in the zoo at Lusaka, Zambia signify? What does it show? Yes? What does it show? That man is the most dangerous animal. What is there in the zoo at Lusaka? There's a cage, and in the cage, is there any animal? Is it any animal? No. What is there? There's a notice, the world's most dangerous animal, and there's a mirror. And when you look in the mirror, you yourself, and then you must read the notice which is written over there, world's most dangerous animal. Now, how are the Earth's principal biological systems being depleted? We have discussed this. I'll just tell you once again. You should know which are the four principal biological systems. Which ones are they? They are the fisheries, the forests, the croplands, and the grasslands. How they're being depleted? By human activity, excess of fishing. We are cutting down the forests. Right? We're not taking care of our environment. The grasslands, the croplands, overgrazing, and yes, the crops, because of too many pesticides and fertilizers, what is happening to it? So it is just being ripped off its fertility, the earth, right? And it will take here many, many years for us to restore it because there's so many chemicals inside it. So this is how the biological systems are being depleted. Now, why does the author aver that the growth of world population is one of the strongest factors distorting the future of human society? human population is there. It's controlling, it is one of the most important things we need to take care of. More population, more mouths to feed, more resources, right? And as a result, what is there? Our danger, our life is in danger, our future is in danger. So it is one of the biggest factor which is distorting the future of human society, population. We need to control the population. And what is happening? Who is getting the benefits? The rich are getting richer and the poor, they continue to be poorer. And yes, here, because they are not aware of the problems which happens because of large families, they, you know, like, yes, they think that having a large family will ensure that they have more money, right? But what happens before that? It means more mouths to feed. And what if they're not able to teach them? They're not able to send them to school. What will happen? They'll end up, yes, as daily wagers, not having a good life, borrowing money, and leading a life of poverty. It will continue. So, right, it is very, very important that people should be aware about the problems of having a large family. So population control is very, very important for the development to be seen. Okay, right. Now, laws are never respected nor enforced in India. What happens here? Yes, laws are never respected nor enforced in India. Why? So laws here, especially related to the environment, we talk about, they're never respected, they're never enforced. And as a result, we don't take care of the wildlife, we don't take care of the forests. We're talking about here, right? It's not only articles related to the environment, but it is also we have regarding untouchability, we have casteism, we talk about bonded labor. So many rules are being broken, so many laws being broken. It's very important that we obey them, we be concerned. A law is a law, right? So we have to take care that everybody follows it, okay? Are we to leave our success as a scorched planet of advancing deserts, impoverished landscapes, and an ailing environment? So what will happen? If you don't take care, the forest cover will reduce. Already the grasslands are going to become deserts because of overgrazing, right? The cattle there. And as a result, what is going to happen? What is going to happen? So green areas are going to become deserts, right? We're already exploiting the water table. There's hardly any groundwater left. And what is going to happen? It's going to turn dry, everything. We end up living in a desert, right? Yes, so are we going to do this? So our activities, if you don't think about what we're doing, this is what the future is going to be like. We are going to have a planet with deserts. We'll have planet with an ailing environment. We'll have a planet with impoverished landscapes, okay? We have not inherited this earth from our forefathers. We have borrowed it from our children. Yes, this is very important that we remember this. This does not belong to anybody. Does not belong to me, does not belong to you, did not belong to our parents, right? Because we are here very temporarily on this earth. So if we are here, let us be concerned citizens. Let us be responsible citizens. Because this planet, where have we got it from? We got it from our children. We are borrowing it from them. Let us live on this planet. And because in a good way, in a responsible way, and naturally there's nothing more precious as children for parents. And if they want to give something to their children, it should be in a good condition. So how should our planet be? In a good condition before we hand it over to our children. The problems of overpopulation that directly affect our everyday life. There, you see it every day. As I just said, nowadays we see the pictures here of the crowded areas, the markets, If there is a festival celebration, how much rush, how much crowd. You go to the railway stations, the crowd over there. You go to hospitals, right? You have lines of people waiting, right? So it is there every day. What about the traffic on the roads? The number of vehicles increasing. And as a result, we are there facing a lot of problems. So all these things are there which are causing a lot of problems to all. Okay, right? Yes, so you need to go through these questions here and we have done, you know, like time and again, so many posters. We have done speeches also about taking care of the earth, taking care of the environment. We celebrate Earth Day. We celebrate Environment Day, isn't it? But it is not only a day to be celebrated, but it is a responsibility to be understood. Okay, right? We've also done posters on saving water, isn't it? We've done posters on how to keep our planet clean and green and keep our city clean. We know the hazards of using plastics, right? So all these things, if we are aware of as children, how can you be responsible? Tell me, if you have to take care of the environment, what would you do? What can we do? Yes? What can we do? Anybody would like to give me the answer? No one? Very bad, very bad. Okay, so with this, we come to an end to this chapter. I'll be sharing with you the textual questions that you are supposed to do. These four questions you'll be writing down in your notebook. Am I clear? Yes? So four questions we'll be doing. Other questions also I'll be sharing with you all. Okay?